10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4.
The Litefoot Show.
It was all a dream.
One for the treble, two for the bass. Litefoot.
Y'all know we run the town.
Litefoot.
Y'all know we run the town.
Litefoot.
Y'all know we run the town.
The Litefoot Show.
Well, hello there, everyone, and welcome to the
Litefoot Show.
Litefoot Show, episode number 22.
Yes.
Want to say again thank you to everybody out there for your support, for listening. You may notice in the background, Spider-Man just literally, you just missed him as he was going up to the top of the building here.
Yeah.
This proves to you that this isn't a picture. This is really the background. And, you know,
for those of you listening, you'll have to check out the video.
Why you need to watch the youtube.com/Litefoot channel and check out the live video version, the video cast of the podcast.
Never know what's going to happen.
You never know what's going to happen. And, of course, the visuals are always so much better than just listening. But we want to say thank you to everybody that subscribes to the podcast.
Definitely.
Appreciate you. Please share it. Please make sure to let your friends know about it. And if you have any, you know, questions that you'd like for us to answer on the show, if you have any comments, suggestions, we're more than happy to receive them at show, S-H-O-W, at L-I-T-E-F-O-O-T.com. Mm-hmm. Send them over to us, and we'll make sure that we'll get them on the show. We have a few today. We'll get to that in a little bit. So let's get into it. Welcome. We want to say thank you to our you know, what would any show be without a sponsor? Native Style Clothing, thank you so much for great, tremendous support.
Mm-hmm.
Born This Way.
Yep.
You know, of course, if you're listening on the podcast, you're going to have to go over to the nativestyleclothing.com site and check out the Born This Way shirt.
Yes.
We're wearing them today.
Yep.
And, so thank you to the amazing, great
so people. Glad they were able to make this happen.
All your Christmas holiday shopping you could do for everybody in the family, literally, right over there at nativestyleclothing.com.
Ah, shameless. So, shameless plug.
Hey, you know. I just feel strongly about the folks at Native Style Clothing.
I do too.
Anyway, and by the way, lightfoot.com/store.
Yeah.
And of course the website, go visit the website if you haven't. Let's get into the show.
Okay. It's been a minute, right?
Let's just keep it real. Last week we took the kids to New York City.
Right, and we had this great idea of doing the podcast.
And humped all the stuff, carried all the stuff.
That's carried, it's a better word.
Well, I mean, I'm thinking about it in sort of military terms, because, I mean, they say that you got to, you know, hump your backpack up the hill.
In this day and age, let's go with a carry.
So we labored with the equipment all the way to the East Coast from the West Coast.
Mm-hmm.
And the idea that we would record the podcast in the hotel room
with our kids,
somewhere,
with our kids,
some, you know, in the vicinity, let you hear all the excitement of the Davis family in real time. And you know, I gotta say, with some of the stuff that ended up happening, that I had to go do.
Yeah,
I had to run over to Washington D.C.
Mm-hmm. Which was crazy, because that was like a three hours there,
3 hours back.
Mm-hmm.
But duty calls, you got to do what you got to do.
Right.
And I had to go over there.
Mm-hmm.
That was 6 hours. I think I was there literally on the ground in New York City about the same amount of time as it took me for me to get there and back.
Yeah.
So it was a really long day.
Right.
I've been fighting a cold, trying to push through that.
Right.
You know, hey, look, no excuses. Nobody cares about excuses. So it was just get it done, make it happen. And that's what we did.
Right.
Come Wednesday, when we were supposed to do it,
I
just was like, you know what, look.
We actually were going to try to do it Facebook Live, too, right?
We were going to try. And it was just all a fail. We just didn't do any of it.
Well, but, you know, here's the thing, too, is because you kind of had to leave for a day, we kind of lost a day as, you know, as our family trip. So
I had to put the family. Not that you're not important. But the family had to take the priority.
We were out there, and they were just all excited about, you know, and the thing is that I tried to take them out the day, well, I did take them out for a little bit the day that you went to D.C., but, you know, it's not the same. It's not the same without you.
Oh, there you go. Thank you. I appreciate it.
And especially with the boys.
Is this a shameless plug, too?
No, it's real. They were like, you know, especially Quanta. He was like, well, where are we going to go, and what are we going to do? And he was like, well, let's just wait for Dad. And then they were like, the two little ones, yeah, let's just wait for Dad. And it was just, you were missed.
Well, thank you.
Yeah. it just wasn't the same.
Well, I appreciate that. Thank you. I appreciate that. So I didn't want to, you know, further rob time away from the family because this seems like it's just, you know, for, 30 minutes or an hour or whatever that the podcasts end up being in runtime. But then there is the editing. Not that we edit the show, but that, you know, you've got to bring it all together because the audio is recorded separately from the video, and then they've got to put it all together. Then they got to upload it, and the upload time takes a huge file. And then, of course, I've got to, you know, get our folks to the audio so that they can upload the audio because it's two different distribution mechanisms. It's a lot of work.
More
than what people probably look at and see. So, you know, it wouldn't have been just like, let's take 30 minutes and do it really quick or do an hour. It's at least 2-3 hours minimum to get it all done once it's recorded. So, you know, family first, had to have that balance. So we're going to actually do two episodes and get that in.
Just get caught up.
Just get caught up, man. A lot of stuff, a lot of crazy been happening. And so anyway.
But, you know, the New York trip was good. That was the first time that we took it was my first time being there during the holidays, and we got to see the Rockefeller Christmas tree at the plaza, right? Or center.
I think they call it both. But.
And the ice rink. And so it was a really awesome kind of a bucket list thing
for us to do. I've said it before, and I think we all are kind of big Christmas geeks. We do Christmas.
Yeah.
You know, I think on the last episode we talked about 44 Christmas trees that we have in the house.
Not really.
But, I mean, we do Christmas pretty tough.
Yeah.
You know, I think, again, it was an amazing experience. Mm-hmm. I would highly recommend it for anybody that, you know, is planning a vacation to do it around that time if you get the opportunity to. And, I mean, this is coming from folks like us that literally never took vacations up until just a few years ago.
Yeah.
Just working so hard and working so consistently and just pushing through, you know, constantly just grinding. We are kind of taking a little bit of a time right now to just, you know, try to find some more balance and just enjoy life at the same time because you got to have it.
Well, it's about making memories, you know. It's about just being together as a family, and especially when you have two younger ones. Obviously, we did some things with our older one, but
correct.
Woo! Anyway, so
by the way, I'm glad you were born this way.
Yeah, thank you. I'm glad I was born this way too.
Yeah, I appreciate. Yeah, and for those of you that don't know what I'm talking about, you have to go to datastyleclothing.com and find out. And then, before I headed over there, I went to Minneapolis, where it was a nice, fairly
freezing.
Warm. Well, it got a little cold when the wind blew. But, yeah. I mean, it wasn't like.
Well, it was snowing.
December in Minnesota.
Oh, wow. I'm thinking of the other trip. Sorry.
Come on, girl. What are you talking about?
I was talking about when you went up to.
When I went. Well, I had gone to Minnesota.
Grand Portage.
I mean,
for people I'm getting your trips shows, mixed up here.
The past episodes, I mean, it literally was, you know, Chicago back to Michigan, back Chicago.
Even I'm getting
Minnesota,
your trips mixed
up. back to Minnesota. I mean, it's been a very,
a whirlwind.
Very busy year.
Mm-hmm.
Grateful, thankful to be busy. But, you know, at the end of the day, I'm not mad that things are winding down, you know, at this time of the year.
Right.
Spend it with family. We are going to take a little datecation. Is that a word? Is that a saying? Datecation?
Yeah, we are.
Just a few days. Mm-hmm. You know, again, we just got done running New York.
Yeah.
I'll say we ran New York for a few days. It was good. It was really great. I mean, just to have the opportunity to let, you know, I was, my first trip to New York City was when I read for Indian in the Cupboard.
Wow.
So I was like, you know, early in my life, but still, all of our boys have been to New York City. Yeah. Well, Quanah's been multiple times, but Sequoia's been a couple times, mm-hmm. and then this was Quinn's first time to New York City.
Yeah.
And so just giving them the understanding of the world a little bit more, mm-hmm. and what's out there. I think Quinn was just blown away by the enormity of it. And it just, it helps them sort of frame the world a little bit more. That, that there's a bigger thing out there, and that you got to be on your game, man.
Yeah.
It's a big world.
Exactly. And,
so, you know, it was a great experience. Speaking a little bit about that, a little bit of New York's coming to Seattle.
Mm-hmm.
Gonna go check out my boy.
Yeah.
Sean Carter.
Yes, tonight.
Got front row seats.
I'm excited.
Don't be mad. Don't be hating out there. 444. Gonna be in the building tonight. C-Town.
Yeah, I'm excited
for that. Front row.
Definitely.
You know, yeah. I mean, why not? I feel like I've never seen him perform.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know,
yeah, really. Crazy. We actually haven't. I just realized
usually you
that.
Would see him perform, and then something would happen where you would meet him, and then
right
you know, kind of goes that way.
Right.
Not that you like meet and hang and meet
and then,
see and
right.
kind of doing stuff with them, and then go see a concert.
Yeah.
It's a little different, but that's gonna be hot.
Yeah, I'm excited.
Taking our oldest.
Yeah. Not the youngest.
No.
Not the youngest.
No time for potty breaks right in the middle of the concert.
Keep it real.
But I mean, we took him to see you too.
Yeah.
Sequoia.
Sequoia. You did good. Yeah. Yeah.
You did good. So anyway, that's kind of been the little update that's been going on with us. So glad to be back. You know, took a week, you know, just to kind of focus on our stuff. I really appreciate all the support, all the comments.
Definitely.
You know, definitely checking Facebook, definitely checking the social media, and I'm seeing people that are saying things about the show and of course about footnotes and about how much it's helping folks. So just want to say thank you to everybody out there that is being inspired, encouraged, mm-hmm. motivated by the content. Trying to help provide a different point of view on some of the national, you know, conversation and issues. You know, from our perspective, how that news hits us.
Right.
You know, I mean, we don't get into everything. It's not really, you know, what we're
doing. Yeah, I mean, we're not trying to be like a news show, but just some of the, I think, hot topics, really. Yeah. But
not
even
like the clothing store, but gotta wait for that sponsorship to come in.
Right. But just, you know, some things that I think really also affect Indian country and pertain to Indian country.
Speaking of which.
Yeah, speaking of which, we didn't get to...
Our commander-in-chief continues to go in on Indian country with bear's ears.
Right.
Had the opportunity to speak with some of the folks from the Ute Indian Tribe. Fort Deschene. What's up, everybody out there at Fort Deschene, Utah? Anybody, you know, that's listening from that neck of the woods? And, you know, hear firsthand what... This is really what it means to them, this reduction in the size of the area and sort of taking that protection
away. Mm-hmm.
You know, and just, you know, I guess what we really have to look at as Native people is where do we regain leverage?
Mm-hmm.
And I think... When it's not broke, you don't have to fix it.
But if it is broke.
But see, I'm a kind of a person, even if it's not broke, I'm always looking at how to sharpen the stick.
Right.
And I know we do.
How to get better.
How can we do that better? How can we do this better? But when it is broke, mm-hmm. and it's not, you may not think it's broke.
Right.
And nobody's telling you it's broke.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're not getting the result
right.
that you want, then you got to change your methods.
Right.
You got to change your process. You got to change the way you go about it. Looks like Spider-Man kind of must be doing something up there. You gotta pay attention to that, right?
Right.
Because if not, then it becomes the definition of insanity.
Yeah.
Doing the same thing over and over and over and over again, expecting a different end result. And
right.
I mean, I gotta be honest with you, in courts, in this administration, and kind of for, you know, we get really excited about these wins, and I'm not saying we shouldn't,
mm-hmm.
but given the amount of wins we should have been collecting versus what we've gotten. And then compare that to the amount of struggle and the L's we've taken,
yeah.
especially in the courts recently around sovereignty, around
right.
decisions that the courts are handing down. We've been taking a hell of a lot of losses,
yeah.
big time losses. And when you look at people paying attention to what you're recommending for a tax bill, and they just don't, not like they put some of something in
right.
or a little bit of something in, they just completely unilaterally didn't put anything in.
And it's like, deliberate. I mean,
you
better believe it's deliberate.
But then at the same time, why would they? What's the impetus? What? Why would they do it if there's no repercussions for them?
Right.
Why would you do it if there's no... What are you going to do if they don't,
mm-hmm.
right? I mean, that's at the essence of negotiation. You got to have something somebody else mm-hmm. wants or somebody else that something needs, or you got to have some, and they call that leverage.
Yeah.
If you don't have any leverage, you can't negotiate.
Right.
It's impossible. I mean, that's just a really quick business conversation.
So
that's not
so
even
how
a
do
lunch.
How do you get out of that situation.
You got to stop doing what you've been doing. You've got to change your expectations. You got to redefine what your value is. You got to look at the world. You got to step back from the forest and look at the trees.
Right.
And you got to see what's really going on.
Right.
And reassess
your strategy.
You've got to relook at your strategy. You've got to fall back.
Mm-hmm.
You've just got to fall back. Because what you're going to do, if you stay on the battlefield and under those conditions,
right.
you will get everybody wiped out. Because you get to a point where you've forgotten that sometimes this is not a good day to fight.
Yeah.
And you may even win a battle, but you end up losing the war.
So, I mean, definitely this is the time, I think, come together whole.
And
I think, you know, we're not really doing that too well right now.
That's a huge problem. Huge problem. But one of the things that I was thinking about kind of as a continuation, we got to look at who our allies are.
Mm, right.
And are they really allies? I mean, we call a lot of people friends, but,
mm-hmm.
you know, your friends are really the people that show up when it's not in the best or most advantageous position for them to be your friend.
Right.
And you can probably count through your lifetime on half of one hand who those people are.
Right.
And I think it's no different for Indian country. Who are your real friends? And I think this is where we got to expand the conversation. And it can't just be around certain key issues. It
mm-hmm.
can't be myopic. It's got to be much grander, much broader. And that really comes from telling the story and communicating what the narrative is. And that's really what I think we don't have right now is
right.
control of the narrative. Other people have been telling our story for years and years and years, and we have to collectively come together because you're not going to do it individually.
Right.
You're not going to individually change the national or international narrative, one tribe or a group of tribes or one region. And it seems that Indian country has been very fractionated into groups. And we come together under a guise of something, but obviously if that was working, we would have a different end result.
Mm-hmm.
So it looks like everybody's kind of watching out for their front yard, probably their backyard. But what's happening in your neighborhood is your problem.
Right.
And that's got to stop.
Mm-hmm.
We have to start thinking about if it's going on in your front yard, it's going to eventually affect my front yard. And it may not be that we even live in the same neighborhoods. You could live on the other side of town. And I'm not talking, you know, I mean, generally, if that town's the United
right.
States or if it's even North America, it'll eventually all come back to your neighborhood. And I think then people start to get upset. But by the time that it does that, it's too late.
Right.
You become reactive instead of proactive. And in the minute you become reactionary to anything, you've lost. You know,
mm-hmm.
it's like in karate, what do they teach you? The best place for you to be as an aggressor, you know, most people think I'm going to be in front of you. No. The best place for you to get, you may start out in front. But the most perfect place for you to be in a fight is behind somebody
mm-hmm.
because you're controlling the fight then.
Mm-hmm.
And it, when we get behind, when we allow people to get behind us, it's really hard to regain control of that. Because they can see what you're going to do before you do it, and then they can position themselves to get ahead of you.
Right.
So it's really hard to get out from around that situation. Yeah. So I think we really have to reassess, you know, who we're collecting our information from, you know, who's guiding these conversations. And, you know, there's so many important folks out there. Indian country, we've got plenty of attorneys. We got you know, great folks out there. We not to say that we don't need, you know, to continue to refresh the ranks, mm-hmm. but for right now, I think we can take a 10-year hiatus and just focus on let's get more business people pushed through the ranks in college. Let's get more Masters of Business Administration degrees. Let's get more folks that are out there understand accounting. Let's get more people out there that understand how to plan and strategize in their communities and how to develop infrastructure and to really create those kinds of visions from that point of view.
Right.
Then to come back and let our legal teams know what they need to do better. You know, no disrespect. I know there's a lot of great folks out there that have their legal degrees.
There. Right, right. No disrespect at all.
You know, that also have an MBA.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, how many of those business folks or how many of those attorneys have ever run a business?
Right.
Probably not very many, right? And I see a lot of them dictating economic development for Indian country. No shots fired, man. And it's been great for a lot of folks to be able to do that. But we need business people mm-hmm. that understand how to start up a business, run a business, market. The degree of marketing folks and folks that have communications backgrounds are not extensive in Indian country right now.
Right.
And we need more people like that.
Right, because that's how you tell your story, right?
If you can't tell it, it's never going to get told. If you can't tell it, you're never going to have a successful business. You have to. I mean, it's the old saying, you got to tell to sell.
Right.
And we have to realize that as the federal government is continuing to look at ways to cut mm-hmm. funding for Indian country, if we don't start figuring out how to fend for ourselves and take care of ourselves, which is kind of a double-edged sword, it ends up being one of those situations where almost every time you try to do something out of the box,
they try to
the government wants to say, you know, you can't do that.
Exactly.
And it really begins to be one of those conversations of, well, what does sovereignty mean?
Right.
If sovereignty means that I can only do what you tell me to do or allow me to do, mm-hmm. how sovereign is sovereignty?
Right.
I mean, I'm just saying.
No.
I think these conversations
I mean, need to be had, really, you know, because our young people, I think, which ultimately this is going to affect the most, right, is our future generations. The decisions and everything that's going on right now affects them. And so if we don't teach them a different way right now from the beginning.
And the only way to teach them is to show them.
Right.
You know, the only way to really show somebody a way forward is to do it yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And to make that action speak louder than your words. And that's mm-hmm. tough. I get it. It's tough for people. We need to really, you know, we really need to stand back and look at what we're doing to get ourselves out of the situation.
Right.
You know, I watched this video the other day of these people. I think I even watched it with our little guy. You saw it.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
About the people standing there on top of the quicksand.
Yeah.
They were fine.
Right.
But the more they tried to move to get out of it, they mm-hmm. immediately started to sink.
Yeah.
And then the more they struggled, the deeper they sunk.
Right.
So it's possible for you to realize for a second, oh my gosh, I'm sinking.
Mm-hmm.
And what's your natural response? To try to work really
and
hard to get out of it and panic and freak out. Oh my God. And the more you do that, the deeper you go.
Yeah.
The thing you have to do is stop, get your senses, realize the slower you move, the more intentionally you move,
mm-hmm.
you get out of that situation.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel that sometimes people get whipped into a frenzy. And because we don't have a plan to begin with, we
ended up in the quicksand.
And now we're in the quicksand and we really don't have a plan.
Mm-hmm.
Now what are you going to do?
Right.
And now oh my God, there's an emergency. We got to do something.
Yeah.
And then you just get, you know, sink deeper and sink deeper and deeper and deeper. And that's what we can't have happen.
Yeah.
So we have to be more intentional. And I feel like, you know, that's something that we're probably going to work on, trying to provide some facilitation of a conversation in this country, in Indian country, and amongst our people about how do we do that?
Right.
How do we move beyond that?
Right.
And how do we come together? And how do we work towards a better day? And, you know, this should be supported. This should be advocated for by those true friends of Indian
mm-hmm.
country.
Absolutely.
This isn't a threat.
This is us trying to be...
Sovereign.
Sovereign.
This is us trying to
self-sustain.
To be self-sufficient, self-sustaining, you know, to look at regaining the beauty and magnificence of our nations
mm-hmm.
and our people and who we are. And who wouldn't want that? Who
right.
wouldn't want something good for a people? You know, I mean, if that offends you
mm-hmm.
or if that concerns you, you need to do a systems check
yeah.
because that shouldn't be that way. So I don't know if Spider-Man just fell or I see he's over there now. Swinging around. It must be a long battle. It's happening up on top of the roof of this building with Spider-Man. But for those of you that are listening to the podcast, there's a rope, a Spider-Man rope hanging. Swings in front of the mirror sometimes, or the window, and then it swings over there. But looks like Spider-Man's got all he can handle today. But anyway, you know, part of this resurgence and reemergence of I think a new day for Indian country really is the folks listening to this podcast.
Yep.
You know, it's the change has got to start individually.
Absolutely. I agree with
our
that.
Our people have to reclaim their individual sovereignty and be self-sufficient and sustaining
right.
themselves.
Right.
And it's tough. I know a lot of people sitting out there going, well, how come this and how come that? And we talked about this in an episode before.
Yep.
I mean, we even catch it.
Yeah.
I mean, we work really, really hard, man. I mean, we earn our money.
Yeah.
And we earn our success. And people that have just been following the episode for, you know, episode 22 right now and just have been following this show over the last few months are maybe getting a little bit more in-depth understanding of what it's taken me over the last 20-plus years
right.
to get where I'm at. Yeah. We still get it from people. I know it's one of the questions that have come up from people over
yeah.
and over again. You know, somebody becomes successful, somebody works
right.
very, very hard, and the next thing you know, their own family
right.
or people that are close to them start talking smack about them.
Yeah.
It's almost like, well, you owe me something
mm-hmm.
if you've worked really hard to get something.
Exactly.
And that's not really the message. The message is if I'm doing something, let that resonate with you that it's possible for
and
you to
do it.
Something.
You can do it too.
This handout mentality
mm-hmm.
of that somebody is owed something is probably one of the most difficult conversations to have.
And that
Indian
all
country.
Of a sudden, you know, after, you know, thousands of years, or not thousands of years, hundreds of years of the government doing us wrong, all
feels
of a sudden,
like a thousand years.
That's, it really does. To have this, also this mentality and this expectation that they're going to do the right thing, like starting this year.
Or next year.
Or the year after.
Or just because it's a Democrat, or just because it's a Republican.
Right. It's...
You got to understand, man, that they're under the bigger thing, which is the United States of America. And
right.
it's that mentality that's caused us the issue. And if somehow, I mean, and I'm not saying you don't fight. I'm sure there's people go, oh, so what are you supposed to do? Just sit back and do nothing?
No,
I'm
no,
not
no,
saying
no.
That.
We're not saying that at
we're
all.
We're not saying that.
At all.
But
we're saying get yourself right.
We're saying get yourself right.
So
but
that
if you are going to do something, stop doing stupid things that don't work.
Right.
Right? Because it is stupid. If
right.
you've tried it and tried it and tried
you
it,
you got to try
and
something
it's not
else.
Working. It's not saying don't do something.
It's saying try something else.
Be smarter about it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it may not be something that you've subscribed to or something that you've been an advocate for, but if it's failing folks,
right.
you owe it to everybody to stop doing it.
Right.
And reassess the situation and do something different.
Right.
Chart a new course. It's just...
And it's hard to do that, though. It is hard. I mean, it does take...
You know
take...
why it's hard? I think...
Why?
Because people don't have a freaking clue.
Right.
They don't know the answer.
Right.
And because nobody sits down and has those conversations collectively and together.
Right.
They don't. They somebody gets this, here's what we're going to do. And then somebody else, oh, yeah. And then you get two or three of those. And maybe they have short-term wins.
Mm-hmm.
And then it doesn't go anywhere. And then people have, you know, so sunk themselves into those initiatives,
right,
they can't come back. They're painted into a corner. And I think that's what we got to stop doing.
Yeah.
We have to collectively come together and chart a course and really look at everybody's strengths and weaknesses and make sure that the thing that we're doing is collective in bringing all the strengths to the front and pushing that forward, unifying our voice, stop the fractionation, stop the fragmenting,
mm-hmm.
stop the dissecting and the divisive behavior.
Right.
Dissecting of whatever energy, the so short-term thinking of it's just about this neck of the woods or about that neck of the woods.
And we're just going to do our own thing, and so they can do whatever they want. I don't care what they do. We're doing our thing.
And that seems to me to be where sovereignty becomes self-serving in a very internally driven initiative.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Because sovereignty then becomes the justification for you to do whatever the hell you want to do, whether it makes any good damn sense or not.
Right.
I don't know. I mean, again, not to say that sovereignty hasn't yielded Indian country many, many
right.
different
this
things.
Right. This is not to bash anybody. This is just saying that we have to do something different if we want to see different results.
Well, because none of those things that we've yielded from that have gotten us to a place where our communities are self-sufficient or sustainable.
And here's the bottom line, is that our young people who are dependent on us right now to do something different, we don't have 60, 70 years to get something right. You know what I mean? Like, it's...
I think Spider-Man is feeling what you're saying because he came back over here. I'm just waiting for a... You know what I think you should do is, like, CGI a Spider-Man.
Oh, no, don't do it.
Looking in like, you know, hey, what's up, everybody? I agree with that.
Anyway, I think it's tough.
Hey, look, it didn't get here overnight.
Uh-huh.
It's not going to change overnight. But if we don't start really becoming more realistic about what it is that we're looking at and how that we're going to deal with it, what we can absolutely rest well knowing is we'll hand this down to our grandchildren.
Absolutely, and that's why it has to become of urgency right now.
I remember in one of the wrap-ups for a testimony to Congress a couple years ago that I took part in, somebody at the very end of it read statements from tribal leaders who had testified to Congress almost 100 years ago, and it was the same conversation.
That kills me.
It was the same conversation.
Yeah.
Shout out to everybody that's grinding. I know there's a lot of incredibly great people out there that are doing everything they can possibly do on a daily basis.
Definitely.
This is not, anything to take away from everyone out there that's working extremely hard to try to do everything that they're doing. But I think that we owe it to future generations to while those things are going on, to make sure that there's other conversations that are happening simultaneous with that,
mm-hmm.
to reassess not just the immediate threats, but the ongoing threat, and really assess what we do moving forward, and how that we're going to get past it, how we're going to get beyond it, how we're going to fix that, because if we sink all of our hopes into any one administration or any one party,
right.
Political party, the joke's on you.
Yep.
And we're seeing it play out over and over and over again. So we have to really assess how do we get to a better day that's more sustainable, that's more self-sufficient, so that we can really look to a time where sovereignty actually means something to people more than just us.
Yeah, I agree.
And if you don't like that, then don't subscribe to this podcast. One of the things we did talk about while we were in New York is making the podcast a little bit shorter. and with that, let's get right into our topic because we just have a little bit of time left.
Yep.
We want to make these around 30 to 40 minutes, and we're at 34 right now. So let's spend a little bit of time
So the main topic is, it takes money to make money. And this is from... this is from footnote number 33, which footnotes... it's a motivational inspirational variety snippets. Of topics,
yeah. To encourage folks, it's just me kind of taking a topic mm-hmm. that comes to me, however I got it.
I'm just going with it.
Just living life and just kind of put my two cents in about it. It's been something that I feel like a lot of people have been encouraged, inspired, motivated by, and you know, you can just look at the Facebook comments or any of the comments on any of the footnotes. You can check them out at youtube.com/Litefoot, Facebook, mm-hmm. And we put snippets of those on Instagram mm-hmm. And Facebook as well.
Right. And in this one, you kind of talked about that, you know, sometimes money, right? It's people don't want to talk about it. Sometimes we don't know how to get it. Sometimes we don't know how to spend it. Sometimes we don't know how to save it.
But it takes it to get it.
Right.
And so, I mean, that's sort of an obvious thing to say, because there's a lot of folks out there going, man, how am I supposed to start a business? I don't have anything.
Exactly. And that's actually as we've traveled throughout the years, that's one of the things that's probably the most asked question is, how did you get your start? And how do you start your own business? You know, how do you, you know, where do you get the money to start it?
Right. Well, you know, you have to, and then in understanding why do most people fail?
Mm-hmm.
Because they don't start.
Right.
You know, I think... there's so many times in life where you're looking for the perfect time to do this or the perfect time to do that, whether it's to start a family, whether it's to start a business. You know, the answer, I mean, with starting a family, there is no perfect time.
No,
I mean,
not
you
at
can
all.
Sit there and try to plan that, and when am I going to get a raise, and how am I going to get this other money, and this, that,
I'm
going to
be
other.
Pregnant during this time, so right. that, you know, I mean, that's not, it doesn't work that
no,
way.
No, you just have to start, and the same thing with your business, same way with your business. You have to figure out what it is that you actually want to do. Mm-hmm. But you have to also understand, it's not just about, because you can want to do something that nobody's interested in, and that's a hobby, that's not a business.
Right.
And then wonder why you don't make any money at it.
Right.
You got to assess, what's the need?
Mm-hmm.
You know, what is there a need? And then, what are my skill sets?
Mm-hmm.
Because you can identify a need, but it completely not have anything to do with you or your skill sets, and that's going to create failure as well. So it's finding a niche that you can address.
And also what you're passionate about, right? I mean, that's a big part of it.
I think that's where you got to start, actually.
Yeah.
You know, you know what brings you excitement and joy. And I think that if that's the way that you're looking at the world, you're going to naturally look into that and see, hey, well, nobody's doing this, and I think I could do that.
Right.
And I don't see anybody doing this. I don't see anybody fulfilling this need. There's an obvious need for this. Or better yet, nobody even recognizes there is a need for mm-hmm. this, and I could do this. And it could be so many different things. And I feel like when you look at those things, you don't just go out and run out and start doing something. You sit and study, plan how you're going to do it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, literally from step one to step 3001.
Yeah.
And that's not to say that plan's going to hold all the way through.
Right, because a lot of times
things
doesn't.
Things change.
Right.
You know, you might get into it and understand things better than you ever knew, mm-hmm. and you will. I mean, that's going to happen.
Yep.
And you just stay malleable. And I think, you know, we did a footnotes about this, about be like water. You have to be able to bend, shape yourself and be malleable to adjust, to improvise, to overcome whatever that you start encountering along mm-hmm. that road. But you always have this core document, this core plan that you can come back to say, this is where I said I was going to be at this time.
Right.
This is where I'm at right now. Let me reassess this. Let me look at it and let me make sure that
reprioritize
I continue
and figure it out
to stay focused on what I'm supposed to be doing and mm-hmm. how I'm going to go about doing it. Because I think people get into it. Sometimes they get antsy, they get nervous, and they don't stay the course.
Right.
Don't expect for this to happen overnight.
Nothing
good happens overnight.
Or a setback. If they experience a setback, which you will. Right? I mean, it's, and then they're like, oh, this is too hard. I can't do it.
Well, I mean,
and then they quit.
But you know, again, I think it goes back to the plan, too, because you shouldn't really, you know, I mean, it's like being on the football field. They say keep your head on a swivel.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you're running a kickoff back and all you're doing is looking forward and your field of vision is just in front of you and not to the left and the right, and you haven't watched enough film before you started running kickoffs back, that you didn't see other people get, you know, compromised this mm-hmm. way or that way, or, you know, your blockers aren't blocking in that time, you then get your, you know, head removed from your shoulders,
right?
And you're laid out and going, oh, this isn't going to work for me. Well, was your field of vision, I mean, what did you do to get laid out? Because if you would have been looking, or you would have been, you know, paying attention, you might have just, hey, I see this coming over here, I'm going to go this way, get 3 or 4 more yards, and I'm going to go down.
Mm-hmm.
That's a different kind of forward progression and you know, advancement. You know, there's a short stoppage, then you get back up and you go again. When
but
you
I
just
think
get knocked completely out,
you sit
there on the ground and you wonder, is this really for me?
Right. Right.
That's the difference.
And I think
you didn't
when
do
you,
your job.
Right. Exactly.
Not you, but whoever.
Dang.
No, but I'm just saying.
No, but yeah. I think when people get knocked down, that's the part.
The difference between getting knocked down and having your head removed.
Yeah.
I think people don't do the work up front and they get their head removed. And they go, oh, this doesn't work.
But even when sometimes people get knocked down, it could be a series of just getting knocked down. They're like, dang, why am I getting knocked down?
But you know? Here's the thing, though. You know, very few kickoffs result in a complete run back for a touchdown.
Right, yeah. Okay?
So if you understand that, and you make it out to the 25-yard line,
right,
or the 30-yard line, for those of you who don't know football, you're probably going to be lost right now. You're like, hey, wait a minute. That was not bad. So perspective is important.
Yes.
Okay. So
definitely. If
you even make it to the 21-yard
uh-huh. line,
that's better than if you would have took a knee in the end zone.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
So if you make it out to the, but if you don't know any of that,
and I think that's what
then
you
go,
that,
oh, this
those
sucks.
Are the conversations that need to be had, because I think a lot of people just go out there and expect to like. Run
no.
it all the way,
no.
right? I mean, just...
The world's coming for you, man.
Right.
The world's coming
for you. But that's something that I
think
they're not prepped for, I feel like.
Yeah, well, I would agree with that. Absolutely. And I think people do get out there and they get it handed to them and then start making these false assumptions
right.
that it's not possible and you know, end result of my efforts were it's not... This isn't for us, or this. They made.
Or maybe I made. It's like they start doubting, and you know, maybe this isn't like you said. Maybe
and
this
it
isn't for
other
me.
People.
Right.
Other people go, oh, well, I'm never gonna do that.
Right.
When that person,
right.
you know, could have at least maybe gotten as far as the person if they would have been doing their job.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So yeah, I mean, I feel like you know, this is sort of a whole. It's in alignment with takes money to make money, because you're never going to make any money if you can't keep your stuff moving forward. And, you know, there's nothing wrong with making money. Absolutely. I mean, you know, our people, and making as much as you can make, right? I mean, why would you try to make money and just go, oh, I'm only going to make a little bit? I mean, who thinks that way? I mean, I'm not saying money is everything.
No, absolutely not.
But if your money is based on your capability or your money is based off of your talents, why would you ever say, oh, I'm just going to be this talented?
Right.
You know, I'm just going to be this successful.
Because I think money comes with a negative connotation, right?
Right, because it's always been handed to us
right.
by somebody that's only going to give you enough to keep you broke.
Or it's, you know, people are looking at it from like, oh, well, why am I going to do that? You know, the... corporate greed and blah blah this and
no,
blah blah
no,
that why
no,
am I going to go in that direction
just, you know I mean that's people just that is a lot of folks talking about stuff that's an excuse
well and I think also when you own your own business you know money is a tool right and I think sometimes people get that confused and
yeah.
and it, that is you know it takes money to make money and I mean money is a tool.
You know, our people have been the epitome of self-sufficiency and sustainability. We tend to completely always tie that into the earth, and we did absolutely, I believe, do that as good as anybody ever in the history of the earth by making sure that we only took as much as we needed, that we used
right.
everything that we took. You know, and understanding that you know if you respect it, it'll
mm-hmm.
respect you. But we also did. Absolutely engage in economic activities, community to
yeah.
community, nation to nation.
Absolutely.
And we have to realize that our people operated at a very high level
mm-hmm.
of economic activity self-sufficiency in that way that resulted in prosperity for all of our people. Mm-hmm. To think today that that isn't a part of what we should be doing or how we should be thinking is almost disrespectful to everybody that had the sophistication, the ingenuity, the innovation mm-hmm. to live and do amazing things years and years and years and years and years right. ago. And we can't take what's happened to us.
Exactly.
And what's the result of that?
It's a mentality, right?
It has become a mentality of that's what's real. That's who we are. That's what we are.
Right.
No, that's what we've become. Mm-hmm. Let's not embrace it as this is what we'll always be because right. it's only been recently that we've been like this.
Mm-hmm.
So for people that are saying that, you know, you're a sellout if you're self-sufficient. You're a sellout if you're self-sustainable or self-sustaining. Miss me with all that.
Yeah.
Miss me with all that. I'm not about ever having a message be proliferated that is be codependent. That's the way.
Right.
Make sure that you get your first and 15th money. That's going to solve your problems forever. That is never going to solve your problems.
Mm-mm.
That is what's wrong. Mm-hmm. That's what's wrong with our people, I feel, is that we have too many people that feel like that's the best it's ever going to get.
Right.
So we got to find the ways out of that.
Right.
So that people can do the things they need to do to take care of their family, take care of their community.
And be fulfilled as a person, right? I mean, be fulfilled.
Most importantly.
Know your purpose.
And you know, look, it don't mean that it's all about, you know, having anything in the bank account to make
no.
you. Y'all show you some miserable rich people.
Yeah.
Miserable.
I'm good.
Horrible.
I don't want to see that.
And you know some.
I do. Yeah.
So at the end of the day,
right.
that's never going to be that solution. It's never going to make you a better person.
But you know, I mean, it's like you said, you know, I mean, it takes money to make money. And at the same time, you know, money is a tool. And
so how did I do it? You know, it's 46 minutes and 26 seconds into it, right? Is that what you're pointing at?
Yeah.
Thank you. I appreciate that. I can see it right there on the
I'm just making sure you got
recorded.
It.
I got
just,
you.
Just double checking, you know.
I went out and got a minimum wage-paying job on top of me starting my own landscaping company.
Mm-hmm.
And how did I do that? I found a way to be able to buy the equipment
mm-hmm.
by working it off, you know, and then I started creating the revenue to build my own future until I got into bigger things. And I took the education that I had received and doubled down and learned and talked and asked people. If I didn't know it, I asked about it.
Right.
And I knew nobody was going to do this for me, so if I didn't do it for myself, most likely wasn't going to happen. I was the beneficiary right. of a father and a grandfather that had built their own businesses. So I saw that, and that helped me tremendously. And, you know, I think that's why I feel the need to impart some of the things that I've learned through footnotes back to people.
Right.
So that if they don't have somebody in their life that can provide them that information, at least I'm giving them as much as I can
right.
about what caused me the mentality, the lessons, the experiences to move through and be the beneficiary of at least what it is that I can do to help contribute to them not going through those things or for them to think about something a little bit differently
right.
and go, oh, yeah, I never thought about it like that. Let me go do that. And you get to the point where you can get some money. And however, you know, whether it's, you know, any legal.
That's what I was about
any
to say.
Legal, any
because
legal,
we're definitely not advocating
legal,
for illegal activity.
Right, and nothing I did was illegal.
Yes, so that's
any,
not the answer is
nah,
any illegal
I mean,
activity.
I mean, we don't even got to say that.
But I feel like we do.
But anybody that's listening to this, do the work.
Yes.
Right? There is no short-term solution. There is no half-assing this. There
right.
is no lazy way to success. There is no instantaneous success. There is you putting in the time,
yeah.
committing yourself, being dedicated,
yeah.
having a vision, understanding it isn't going to happen tomorrow. Right. It's not going to happen this week. It's not going to happen this month. What I want is 4 years from now, or three years from now, or 2 years from now. What I want is something down there, and I'm going to work every single day, and I'm not going to quit. I'm not going to give up. I'm going to stay focused. I'm going to stay full of perseverance and passion, and I'm going to continue to move forward, whether anybody else gets it or not. And then I'm going to take all that money that I'm making right now, and I'm going to do what I got to do right now to sustain myself. Mm-hmm. And for me, that wasn't going, oh, man, look, I got a few hundred dollars, 500, 600, 800, whatever that week.
Yeah.
And go, man, I'm going and getting a steak, and I'm going to buy some new shoes, I'm going to get a new outfit. You got to look at what are you really trying to get to, and you have to stay focused because there's so much out there that you want to go spend your money on or go do this. I ate 39-cent tacos.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, today, that was, I mean, that was the cheapest thing I could find to continue to eat, to continue to push forward, and then I stacked my money. Mm-hmm. To buy studio time, to buy T-shirts, to buy other things that were going to come back and benefit me for where I was going, to then take those T-shirts and sell those and then stack more money.
Right.
And then go buy more T-shirts and then go buy sweatshirts and then go buy whatever else that I could do to promote myself. So people kind of look at it sometimes like somebody owes you something. Nobody owes you nothing. Mm-hmm. Go out, get a plan, work your plan, stay focused, keep pushing forward, and make sure that you have that path already memorialized in a document, something that you know, whatever that is, and you can come back to it and identify where you were, where you are. That should get you up. That should keep you motivated. You should be really excited about that. And you go, wow, I'm making progress. This is working. And not to say that there might not be some setbacks, but you understand, okay, well, yeah, I shouldn't have done that. Maybe next time I'll know.
Right.
I'll go right instead of going left. Mm-hmm. And then you make the money and you keep pushing forward, and it takes money to make money.
Yep.
And I think that's ultimately what that footnote was about. And it's something that we still understand today. We self-capitalize a lot of the initiatives that we decide to go do.
Yep.
You know, we don't go out and get a loan to make a record. We don't go out and get a loan to put something out. We take our money and then reinvest it. When I was doing movies, I would take the money from the movies and reinvest it in the businesses.
Right.
I didn't go buy a Porsche. I didn't go buy, you know, all that stuff and spend it on all that.
Right.
You know, and I've stayed focused with what I was committed in, what I believed in.
Yep.
And so
it's sacrifice,
when
right?
more success happened, I reinvested the success back in to create more success.
Right.
So be your own answer, man. That's really what it comes down to. Be your own answer.
I like that.
And and make sure that you understand where you're headed, and you'll get there.
I like that.
Whew. Spider-Man.
That is gone.
Yeah, he was like, I understand that. It takes money to make them Spidey outfits. Web shooters. Anyway, thank you.
Yes.
Native Style Clothing.
Thank you.
You're amazing human beings that make amazing clothing. I appreciate you. Thank you for... Born this way.
Yes.
Born this way. Native Style.
Native Style.
Christmas. Make sure and buy Native.
Yes.
Hashtag buy Native. Litefoot.com/store. A lot of great stuff over there. Mm-hmm. You want a unique, incredible gift?
Native Style.
There you go. The chicken seed headdress logo that you see all over the stuff that we have on everywhere Litefoot. Mm-hmm. You can get it on T-shirts, sweatshirts, clothing, whatever it is, cell phone cases. Coffee mugs. Appreciate that. Support the show. Thank you.
Thank you.
Send your questions in. I know that we were going to get to one of the questions here, but since we've run over a little bit on this one,
we'll get to it. On the next.
This and another one on the next episode. Yep. So thank you so
thank
much.
You.
We appreciate you. Continue to subscribe. Watch the show on YouTube.com/Litefoot. The video cast is always as amazing, and even maybe a little bit more. You get to see my beautiful wife, a.k.a. lovely co-host, a.k.a. Native Woman of the Year, on the show. And who wouldn't want to do that? So thank you so much. We appreciate you. Stay strong. Stay focused.
You.
Keep pushing forward. Don't let anybody define your future or anything about who you are. Make sure you do that yourself every single day. We appreciate you. Thank you so much. This has been the
Litefoot
Show.
Okay. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4.
The Litefoot Show.
It was all a dream.
One for the treble, two for the bass.
Y'all know we run the town.
Litefoot.
Y'all know we run the town.
Litefoot.
Y'all know we run the town.
The Litefoot Show.